Hello. Today's lecture will be about linear PDEs of second order. We'll be talking about such notions like hyperbolicity, ellipticity, and parabolicity of a PDE. Okay, let me start with a few examples of PDEs of second order. It is useful to introduce two important second order linear operators. The first of them is denoted by triangle and is called Laplacian. In two dimensions, this is just given in coordinates xy, second partial with respect to x plus second partial with respect to y. In three dimensions, this second partial with respect to x plus second partial with respect to y plus second partial with respect to z. Another operator is called D'Alembertian, and this is denoted by a box or square. And in two dimensions, this box is just second partial with respect, let's say, t variable minus second partial with respect to x variable. In 3D, it's just second partial with respect to t minus second partial with respect to x minus second partial with respect to y. And in 4D, minus second partial with respect to z square z. Okay. Using these operators, we can write down three particular interesting partial differential equations. So the first one is called the heat equation. So it is an equation of the form u sub t equal k, where k is a constant, times Laplacian of u, where the u function in three dimension is a function u of t, let's say x and y, so it is in 3D, and in four dimensions it would be like u of t x y z, right? So that's the heat equation. K is a constant. Another well-known and well-studied equation is the wave equation. The wave equation is an equation for function u that is annihilated by the D'Alembertian. So that's the wave equation, where function u can be like in two dimensions, it's a function of t and x. In three dimensions, it is of t, x, y. In four dimensions, it's t of x, y, z, right? And the last equation that I wanted to mention at this moment is the Laplace equation. And Laplace equation is just like an equation for a function that is annihilated by the Laplacian. And again, in two dimensions, this function depends on x and y. In three dimensions, this function depends on x, y, z. Okay, so these are very important PDEs that we will be just discussing later, but it's good to have them in mind while we talk about our subject today. Okay, note that all of these equations are linear equations, so all of them, note that all three equations are linear. And end of second order. Okay. Today, our main subject will be second order linear PDEs in two variables. The most general equation of this type is of the form where all these coefficients like A, B, C, D, E, F, and G are given functions of variables X and Y. Okay, so that's the most general form of a second order linear PDE in two variables. The left hand side of this equation can be written in terms of a linear operator L acting on function U, and you can read this linear operator of this what is on the left hand side here. Okay, associated with this PDE, there is another linear operator, L0 of U, which is concerned only with the highest order derivatives. So L0 on U is just this operator. Okay, this part of this equation is called the principal part. The principal part of the PDE star. Okay, so that's our PDE star. So what is the principal part? The principal part is just the part involving all highest order derivatives, in this case second order. Part involves all second order derivatives. So this definition of the principal part of the linear PDE, this is the part in which only highest order derivatives of the function of the unknown function appears. Associated with this PDE, there is also a function which is called discriminant. Of the PDE is a function built out of these coefficients A, B, and C, and by definition this discriminant is just b square minus a times c. Okay, so that's the discriminant of an equation. If you are given second order linear PDE in its most general form, it may happen that by changing variables from x, y to some other variables, let's say psi and eta, may bring the PDE star to a simpler form. So it is interesting to see how this PDE changes when we pass from variables x and y to variables psi and eta. When passing from one system of independent variables to another, we have to guarantee that the transformation between the variables is non-singular. Therefore, we have to insist that the Jacobian of the transformation xy coming to psi eta is non-singular. So we want that psi sub x, psi sub y, eta sub x, eta sub y is not equal to zero. So what we want now to do, we want to see what's going on with the PDE when we pass from variables x and y to variables psi and eta. And of course, for this transformation to be a really good transformation, we have to assume this condition. When we pass from variables x and y to variables psi and eta, the equation will change drastically, but there will be some feature of this equation which will be unchanged. And this feature of this equation that doesn't change under this transformation is given in the following lemma. The sign of the discriminant of the PDE star is not changed after change of variables from x, y to psi, eta. Let's try to prove this fact. So I want to see what's going on with this expression when I pass from variables x and y to variables psi and eta. My unknown function that in these coordinates is function of x and y in new coordinates is a function of psi and eta. But because psi and eta is related x and y by this transformation, we have the following. So let us calculate the derivatives of u with respect to x and y. So let's calculate the first derivative. So u sub x, now we use the chain rule. Likewise, u sub y, right? So these are just how first derivative with respect to x of function u are related to first derivative with respect to variables xi eta look like. Now we have to calculate second derivatives. So the second derivatives, we just use Leibniz rule and the chain rule. So it is first u, so we are just differentiating this. So this u sub x, u sub xi times xi sub x plus u sub xi sub eta times eta sub x times xi sub x. So it is when the x derivative heated this. Now there should be x derivative heating this, but I don't do it now yet. Now I will just apply x derivative to this function. So it is u sub eta sub xi times xi sub x plus u sub eta times eta sub x times eta sub x. And now there should be terms when the x derivative hits in here and when x derivative hits in here. But if this happens, the terms that I will get here will have only first order derivatives of the function u, which will be not relevant for me. The only thing that is relevant for me as regards these terms is this, that these terms involve only first derivatives in u. So now let's do the same for u sub x y. So it is u sub xi xi times xi sub y plus u xi eta times eta sub y xi x plus, now if it hits here, it is u sub eta sub xi xi sub y plus u sub eta 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 sub y times eta sub x, and again plus terms of first order in u. And eventually u y y is u sub xi xi times xi y plus u xi eta times eta sub y xi y plus u eta xi times xi sub y plus u eta 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 sub y times eta sub y plus first order terms. Okay, so now if we just insert this into our original PDE, so we calculate u sub xx, we calculated u sub xy, and we calculated u sub yy. So then if you insert this, what we calculated, into this equation, we obtain something like this. So there'll be a xi x squared plus 2b xi x xi y plus c xi y squared, and here will be u xi xi plus, and there will be 2 here, and there will be a of xi x eta x plus b times xi x eta y plus xi y eta x plus c xi y eta y, and what stays here will be u xi eta, and eventually there will be term like a of eta sub xi squared plus 2b eta sub x eta sub y plus c eta sub y squared u eta eta. And here there will be terms like u sub xi plus u sub eta plus u plus equals to some function, let's say g, okay, which doesn't depend on u. So if we just denote this by capital A, this by capital B, and this by capital C, we will get that the PDE, which in xy coordinate looked like at the beginning of this lecture, now in xi eta coordinate it looks like a u sub xi plus 2b u sub xi eta plus c u sub eta eta plus lower order terms. Lower order terms equals to some function g, where a is this thing here, b is this thing here, and c is this thing here. So what we get here, we get a principal part of our PDE in the new variables. So that's the principal part of our PDE in the variables psi and eta. So what is the discriminant of this PDE in this form? So the discriminant now of this equation in terms of variables xi and eta is now b squared minus a times c, right? So we see that A, capital B and capital C is somehow related to A, B, C with non-capital letters. So the question is, what is this relation? And this can be easily understood what it is by observing that the relation between capital A, B, C and small a, B, C is as follows. A, B, we can make the following matrix. And it is matter of checking that these relations mean nothing, that this matrix of capital A, B, C's is related to the matrix with small a, B, C's as follows. So if we take determinant on both sides of this equality, so one has to check it. But I claim that this, what is here, is precisely this, what is given by the relations here. And now if we take determinant on both sides, we get that AC minus B squared is equal determinant of this times determinant of this times determinant of this. But determinant of this and determinant of this is the same, is actually our Jacobian that appeared here. It was this one. So if we just take determinant of both sides, we will have that determinant of this is j, determinant of this is j, so we'll have j squared. And here we'll have ac minus b squared. So in other words, we can write that b squared minus ac, which is nothing but our delta l, is related to b squared minus ac by a factor which is equal to j squared. So since j is not equal to zero, therefore j squared is always strictly positive. So we see that the sign of this expression is the same as sign of this expression. Therefore, the sign of the discriminant of linear partial differential equation of the second order is invariant with respect to the change of coordinates. This suggests the following definition. A second order linear PDE of two variables is called hyperbolic at a point x and y if and only if the discriminant of this equation at this point is greater than zero. The equation is called elliptic if discriminant is negative, and it's called parabolic if this discriminant at this point is equal to zero. So if you are given a second order PDE like this, you notice that it's just linear, then what you should calculate, its discriminant, delta L being b squared minus ac, and you can determine if this equation is hyperbolic, elliptic or parabolic by looking at the sign of this expression. And now we just gave a definition. What does it mean that a second order linear PDE of two variables is hyperbolic, elliptic or parabolic at a point? We can extend this definition to a domain saying that PDE is hyperbolic, parabolic or elliptic in a domain if it is hyperbolic, parabolic or elliptic at every point of this domain. And this definition makes sense because signs of the discriminant are invariant with respect to the change of variables, so therefore the notion of hyperbolicity, ellipticity or parabolicity has an invariant meaning. It doesn't depend on the choice of coordinates. It is convenient to introduce the following definition. The canonical form of a hyperbolic PDE is where L1 is a first order linear operator and G is some function. So that's the this is the canonical form of a hyperbolic PDE. The canonical form of a of an elliptic PDE is where again L1 is a linear operator of the first order and G is some function of variables of the new variables xi and eta. And finally, the canonical form of a parabolic PDE is again, this thing is some first order linear operator and this is some function of variables xi and eta. So now we are passing to the main theorem of this lecture. Suppose that our PDE is hyperbolic in a domain D, or it is elliptic in a domain D, or it is parabolic in a domain D. Then there exist local coordinates psi and eta in which the PDE is in the canonical form. So if it is hyperbolic in the domain D, then there exists coordinate psi and eta such that the equation can be written like this. If it is elliptic, there exists coordinate that it could be written like this. And if it is parabolic, there exists coordinates that it could be written like this. So now I'm passing to the proof of this theorem, and I will only prove it in the hyperbolic case. The proof in the parabolic and elliptic cases is in the book that we are using for this course, respectively in sections 3-4 for parabolic case and 3-5 in the elliptic case. And I think that one of these cases of the proof will be also shown to you during the tutorials of Little Shaman. Okay, so I will concentrate on the proof in the hyperbolic case. So remember, when we were just passing from variables x and y to variables psi and eta, we observed that the functions a, b, c change to functions capital A, capital B, and capital C, and in particular a was equal small a psi sub x squared plus 2b psi sub x psi sub y plus c psi sub y squared, and c was likewise almost the same, but with psi replaced by eta. So if we start with our PDE plus so on, and if we pass to the new variables psi and eta, we obtain an equation of the form A and now if we know that this equation is hyperbolic, we want to prove that it's always possible to find this transformation of variable in which this is zero and this is zero. So in other words, the question is, if given a hyperbolic equation, we can find coordinates psi and eta such that the equation has no these terms. So in other words, the question is, if these two PDEs for unknown functions psi and eta have solutions, Note that function psi and function eta must satisfy the same PDE. So actually what we need to find two independent solutions of the same PDE, which is this one, okay? So let's try to prove that we can find such psi and eta. If both A and C are zero, we already have the equation in canonical form, because when we just divide by 2b, it will be precisely like u sub xy plus first order terms. So without losing generality, we can assume that a is not equal to zero. So we assume that a of xy is not equal to zero, right? So now I will first write something, and then you will understand that what I wrote is just correct. So let me write first something like this, psi sub x plus b minus square root b square minus ac times psi sub y times a psi x plus b plus psi sub y equals zero. And if I put 1 over a here, this thing is precisely this thing. I simply factorized this quadratic expression for psi here. So this equation is precisely this equation. I factorized it, and I could have done it because b squared minus ac is non-negative because we assumed hyperbolicity. This shows that our PDE capital A equal to zero, which is a PDE for the unknown variable psi, is equivalent to two PDEs. Either this holds or this holds, right? So remember that we look for two different solution of this equation, because we want to have one solution, we want to take one solution as psi and the other solution as eta. So actually we have just shown that this equation, which is quadratic in psi, is equivalent to two equations, two linear equations in psi, which differ by sign here. So actually we can either solve this equation, and if we solve this equation, we take its solution as our psi, and we can solve also this equation, and we take this solution as our eta. So if we are able to solve both of these equations, we will have psi and eta. But actually, if we just look at these two equations, they are nothing, but they are actually linear first order PDEs with the right hand side equal to zero. So these are linear first order PDEs with right hand side equal to zero. So we can solve it by the method of characteristics. So we have for the first one, the equations for the characteristic curves is like this. B for this equation will be plus, for this equation will be minus. And the psi over dt for both equations equals zero. So this means that these are equations that we know how to solve. We know in particular that the solution psi or eta must be constant along the characteristics. If we write the equations for characteristics for both of these equations, which is just this, so this is the equation for characteristics. There are actually two of them, because one for variable psi, the other for variable eta. And we know how to solve it. So we just solve these two equations for the characteristics on the xy plane, And once having them, we know that the solution for psi and eta is just constant along these two families of characteristics. Remember that the solution psi of such linear PDE depends on arbitrary function. We just choose this arbitrary function as the simplest one, which is identity, and then take psi as solution with plus sign and eta as a solution with negative sign. So if we solve this equation, then we can kill a and c here, and then by dividing by b, we get precisely the hyperbolic equation in the canonical form. So this finishes the proof. Okay. Let us make one example. Consider a PDE of the form. This definitely second order linear PDE in two variables for an unknown u. And now the question is, what type of equation it is? It is hyperbolic, elliptic, or parabolic? Let's check it. So what is a? A here is 1. B here is negative sine x. And c here is negative cosine squared. Right? So let's calculate the discriminant, which is just b squared minus ac, which is sine x minus sine squared, so this sine squared, minus a, which is 1, times minus cosine squared, so it is just sine squared x plus cosine squared x, which is 1, and is definitely positive everywhere for every value of x and y, right? So this is a hyperbolic equation. Okay, so how this equation looks in the canonical form? Remember what we have to do. We have to find characteristics. So we have to solve the equation like dy over dx is equal b, which is negative sine x, plus minus square root of b squared minus ac, but b squared minus ac is 1, so it is like this, divided by a, which is 1. So we have to solve this equation to find characteristics, and it is very easy to solve. There are two solutions, depending on the sign plus or minus. So y is equal to cosine x plus minus x plus constant, right? So we know that psi and eta could be any function which is constant on characteristics, so any function of these variables. So let's take linear function. So actually psi can be taken as y minus cosine x minus x, and the eta can be taken as y minus cosine x plus x. Okay, so these are the functions psi and eta that we were showing how to find them in the general case here. Now we have shown how to find psi and eta in the example. Now the transformation x, y going to psi eta, which should bring this equation to the canonical form, is given here. And now it is a matter of checking that passing from xy coordinates to psi eta coordinate, this equation takes a very simple form, u psi eta is equal to 0. And of course, it is in the canonical hyperbolic form. Actually, it is in the simplest possible hyperbolic form. And now, because passing from these coordinates to these coordinates bring this equation to this equation, we can solve very easily this equation, because this equation says that the function u as a function of xi and eta should be any function of xi plus any function of eta. Now, passing back to the xy coordinates, we see that the general solution for this equation is u being f of xi, which is y minus x minus cosine x plus h y plus x minus cosine x, where f and h are arbitrary functions. So bringing our PDE to the canonical form enabled us to find its general solution. This illustrates the usefulness of the canonical form.